Are we ready to praise the Lord this morning?
Yes!
I want to encourage you to sing along this morning with this song. This first song is called Mighty to Save. Because I believe that if you want to get stirred up, you know, how many of y'all need to get stirred up in the morning? Sometimes you need coffee and sometimes you need a coke. But I guarantee you, if you'll sing along with this song this morning, let the words just permeate in your heart, you'll get stirred up. Okay? Everyone needs compassion, love is never failing. Then mercy fall on me. Everyone needs forgiveness, the tiredness of sin.
that chorus just one more time with the voices and whatever is going on, just speak to it right now. Declare that God is going to take care of it. You might not feel it, you might not see it, you might have been waiting for a while, but God is still on the throne. He knows your situation. Just sing this in faith today. Let hope rise up. Savior,
He can move a mountain. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save.
Thank you. I need to know if there are any crazy youth in the house. Y'all so crazy we're gonna lock y'all up this Friday. Y'all unashamed are having a lock-in. That's this Friday from 7 p.m. to 9 a.m. Eat dinner before you come. They're gonna have some snacks and drinks, but they ain't feeding you meatloaf and mashed potatoes, okay? So make sure you do that before you come. Also, unashamed has an awesome opportunity to go to St. George Island Christian Retreat Center in St. George Island, Florida. This is a Christian retreat. It's from June 14th to 17th. $75 per person, 3 nights with food included. This is going to be a lot of fun. A summer camp for the youth. You don't want to miss that. Somebody made a comment this morning that our bulletin pack looked like the Shoppers guy. If you haven't noticed, we got, there may not be much going on in Cochran, but there's a lot going on in House of Grace. Yeah. Me and Pastor Joey were out in the community yesterday spreading the word about the Bonehampton concert coming up this Saturday night. And we were like, you know what? There just ain't much going on in Cochran. They like, you got that right. But there is something going on this Saturday night. We want you to get in here by 6:30 so you get a seat, because we're going to pack this place out. How often, somebody name a celebrity that has come to Cochran recently.
Scott Brady.
There you go. Well, we got celebrities here at the church. That's obvious. But other than Pastor Shane and Scott Brady, we've got Bonehampton coming.
Yeah.
That is awesome. He is known as Mr. Crossover because of his clean comedy. He's been on BET, CMT, NBC, TBN, ABC, DEFG. He's been on them all. He's been on movies and TV shows and DVDs. He's won the Dove Award, the Grady Nutt Humor Award for Comedian of the Year. You do not want to miss this. This is going to be a lot of fun. Definitely. Let me tell you about the cost. Free. Kids are not slowing down this summer. They got a lot going on June 21st. 23rd, they're going to the movies. They got a car wash on the 20th, and on the 30th, they're going back. They need more movies. Going back. It's only $1 to go. They go to the movies there in Eastman. And also, we just kicked up the softball season. Today, Team 1 has a scrimmage against Promise of Hope. The men from Promise of Hope are coming over today to fellowship with us and play some softball. That's going to be a lot of fun. Also, if you haven't turned in your jersey orders, please see Alice Dingus for that. A lot of other stuff going on. Just break out your shopper's guide here, and you'll see, man, it is packed full of goodness. And don't forget, when we take up the offering later, to fill out your communication card. We certainly appreciate that. At this time, I would like to dismiss the Kingdom Kids all the way up to, what, fifth grade? All right. There goes the future right there. All right, thank you for your attention, Pastor Joe.
Google for everything instead of God, but sometimes it's good to Google.
and I Googled how many verses are in the Gospel of Mark. Do you know it's the shortest of the four Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. This is the shortest one. So I'm already giving you an easy breezy way to do this thing. If you read 6 verses a day, you would complete the chapter. What I'm going to ask you to do is to read 1 chapter a week. That's not really hard, is it? In fact, it averages out, that would be 6 verses a day. So in the time that it takes you to brush your teeth, you could have read 6 verses in the Gospel of Mark. So what I'm asking you to do, House of Grace, is go ahead and say, yeah, I'm in. And by the end of the day, even when we do our communication card, there's going to be a place where you say, yeah, I'm in. I want you to commit to reading 6 verses of the Bible a day. I'm not asking anything crazy, right? Everybody say, that's a good idea.
It's a good idea.
So we're going to read together, and then when we come together on a Sunday, I'm going to take that chapter. Now, I might not preach the whole chapter. I'm not going to preach the whole chapter today, but I'm going to preach a couple portions of it. So I may or may not preach the whole chapter for that week, but I want you to read the whole chapter. And I let me just speak to the guys real quick. I got any men in the house?
Yeah!
Men, I want to double dog dare you here. I want to challenge you. Everybody say man up.
Man up.
Come on, man, say man up.
Man up.
All right, good. So what I want the men to do is to say, man, 6 verses a day, I got this. I want you to commit to it. I want you to write on your card a little bit and say, Joey, I got that. And what I want you to do is then turn around and preach your household. I want you to say, hey, honey, don't forget to read your verses today. I want you to look at the kids and say, hey, let's sit down and read these 6 verses here. I want you to leave your house this week. And I want you to read the word. And I want you to just hold it. And whatever that looks like in your house, I don't know. And whatever things are coming up in your head right now, well, I don't understand the Bible. I don't have a blah, blah, blah. Everybody say blah,
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 blah.
No excuses, man. It's time to be man up. I got to do it too. And you know, if you think I wake up praying in tongues and read the Bible every day, I don't. I have the same struggles you do. I have to make this flesh get in this word. But it's just like going in the gym. You know, the hardest part about working out and going to the gym is what? Getting there. Once you get there, at least so I hear, that's the hardest part, but once you get there, you're like, man, I'm so glad I did that. It's the same way with the Bible. Now, let me give you a couple verses that will explain to you, just remind you of the importance of the Word. And in just a minute, we're going to get right into the book of Mark. But I want to give you a couple tools. First of all, let me remind you of what Matthew 4:4 said. Jesus said, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every what?
Word.
Everybody say word.
Word.
That proceeds from the mouth of God. Now, I'm going to try not to preach these verses. I'm trying to just remind you of these. I'm going to preach them. That's a good verse to meditate on. That means you can't live by bread alone, by what you eat, by what you make. You're going to need the Word of God. Amen? Hebrews 4:12, you remember this one. For the Word of God is living and active, sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing to the division of soul and of spirit, of joints and of marrow, and discerning the thoughts and intentions of the heart. That's one of my favorite verses to dissect and preach. I preached on it about 6 months ago, but that's worthy of meditation. The Bible actually shows you what's really going on in your heart and mind. All the times I'm going, what's wrong with me? Have you ever asked yourself, what's wrong with me? Why do I do stupid things sometimes? I knew better than that, but I said, what we need to do, if you want to know what's wrong, you're going to need to take the Word of God and say, God, show me what's wrong, and let it go down and discern the thoughts, the intentions, and show you what's really going on in your heart. I need that, and you need that. Amen? How about this one? Psalm 119:11. Our kids, we memorize this as a family. I have hidden your word in my heart that I might not what?
Sin against you.
I've hidden your word because your word helps me to keep from sinning. You know, I don't want to sin, not just because sin is bad and it's wrong and I don't want to make God mad. It's so much more than that. I don't want to sin because sin just messes my life up. See, it ain't even just about, well, I want to make you mad. Sin is dumb. Sin is stupid. And the wages of sin are what? And it always brings destruction. Every time something is wrong in my life, every time I have something, dumb results have happened, bad things, it's usually the result of sin, either mine or someone else's, or the sinful condition of this world. Every bad thing, we can say that out, I can prove it to you. Every bad thing is a result of sin. Mine, yours, or Adam's. Amen? Are y'all okay? I'm picking up the pace, but y'all didn't come with me. Okay, let me give you another verse. Psalm chapter 1, For his delight is in the law of the Lord, and in his law he meditates day and night. This is the guy who reads his Bible. He thinks about it. He chews on it. He shall be like a tree planted by the rivers of water that brings forth its fruit in its season, whose leaf also shall not wither. And if you hadn't got it yet, the last line breaks it down. And whatever he does, he shall prosper. Whatever he does shall prosper. Do you want to prosper? Do you want to be blessed? I'll scratch. Then we're going to have the word. Sometimes I've been, there's several words that I'm going to use about myself that might apply to you. Sometimes I've been naive and thought that I could succeed without God's word. Sometimes I've been downright prideful and thought that I could succeed without God's word. And sometimes I've been rebellious and tried to succeed without God's word. But every time that happens, I fail. And so do you. But if you want to be successful, if you, you know, thy word is a lamp to my feet and a light unto my what? We've got to get into the word. If you think whatever situation you're facing, Savior, you can move the mountains. My God is mighty to say, you know what he's going to use to move the mountains? You know what he's going to use to move the mountains?
Us.
It's going to be his word. It's going to be his word. Now, it might be his word in my mouth, but his word will never get in my mouth and never get in my head. See, it's got to get through my eyes. The pathway to my mouth is first through my eyes and my ears. He that has ears to hear, let him hear. Are we all right?
Yeah.
All right, all right. Yeah, the book of Mark, you got that ready? All right, here's what we're going to call, this series in the book of Mark. We're going to call it the Jesus Revolution. And I don't just say that to like pick some hype you up kind of words, but what I believe we're going to discover as we read through the book of Mark, what I believe happened 2,000 years ago is that a revolution began. I got some proof of it. See, the world was broken. The world's been broken for 6,000 years. You were born into a broken world in a broken state. The Bible calls it our sinful condition. And that everything was disconnected from the Creator, from the Father, the God who created it. But then about 4,000 years in, he got to the place where he said, the time is now. I'm going to come in myself and restore this broken place. I'm going to come in as a man. I'm going to place myself in a virgin girl named Mary. And they're going to name me Jesus, which means Yeshua, the Savior, the Christ, the one who comes to redeem, the one who comes to men to make all things new. And I'm going to come, and what I'm going to do is I'm going to start a revolution. Yes. And 2,000 years ago, Jesus started a revolution. Yes. The crazy thing is, some people still don't know that the revolution has not only begun, it's in full speed, it's in full throttle. You walked into it this morning. You may not have felt it. You may not be feeling it now, but I'm here to tell you, the revolution has begun. Amen. The only question is, will you be a part of it? It's a revolution that can actually go on. It's changing the earth. I've been reading stories this week and just studying the accounts. Things are outpouring. There's outpourings of the Holy Spirit that are unprecedented since the days of Jesus. They have documented people being raised from the dead all over the planet. We're not talking about one or two or a rumor. There's doctors, there's articles, there's proof. Crazy stuff is happening in the world. Jesus is pouring himself out. He's doing signs, wonders, miracles. The revolution is in full speed. But sometimes we sit here like this right here, like some of y'all are looking at me going, whatever. I don't know. Maybe you're not feeling the revolution in your situation. I understand that. We talked last week, there are storms. There's a lot. See, because where the revolution doesn't come easy. That's why we need revolutionaries. Jesus, I'm going to show you the book of Mark. Not only did he begin the revolution, he recruited for the revolution. He's still recruiting today. He's recruiting this morning right here. And it's not based on your qualifications. It's not based on how smart you are, how much of this you haven't memorized yet, not what you did yesterday, not what you've done. It's not based on anything but the revolutionary himself. But you say, well, I don't feel it. You don't have to feel it. You have to believe it. We know this, but we forget that sometimes we're saved so long, we forget the basic things that help to get us here. This ain't about feeling something. This is about the just shall live by feelings. Is that what it says? Without feelings, it is impossible to believe. Is that what it says? No, the just shall live by what?
Faith.
Somebody's got to believe this word before they even see it. When he comes back, will he find feelings? Is that what the Bible says? No, it says, will he find what?
Faith.
I've taught you before, faith is always preceded by and based upon a what? A word. Everybody say word. I want you to remember some of these things today. Please write some of this down, because you're going to need these tools in your tool belt. You're not going to be in church all week. You're going to be in the real world the rest of this week. You need some tools in your tool belt. Faith is always preceded by and built upon a word from God. I've shared with that with you before, but I'm going to preach that till I go to Jesus, because it's so important. Sometimes we say, I believe in God. No, you're not. Because you don't have a word from God. You're hoping. And there's a place for hope. We pray this morning that hope would rise up in you today. Because some of you are discouraged. You're going through legitimately hard times. And you need hope. And God is the author of hope. But he's also the giver of the word. And he's looking for people of faith. Without faith, it is impossible to please God. Why? Because he wants to hit you with a stick? No. You've heard me say it over and over. Hebrews 11:6. Without faith, it is impossible to please God. Because you must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder. Thank you, Jesus. He is a rewarder of those who diligently seek him. God is looking for somebody to reward. The Bible says he's going back and forth looking for someone to believe in him so that he can show himself strong on their behalf. I'm sharing scripture with you today. This is the word of God. I pray that you're being stirred. If you have ears to hear, you will leave your stirred today. Because this is the word of God. It will not return void. The only time it returns void is, the Bible says in Hebrews, I believe it's 3 and 4, it says there was a group of people who heard the word of God, but it profited them not. Because they did not mix it with what? Faith. Everybody say faith.
Faith.
We've got to be a people of faith. But we've got to have a word. So you can't have faith until you have a word. Last week we talked about the storm. What do you need in the storm? A rowboat? No, you need a word. Do you need a life jacket? No, you need a word. Do you need a paycheck? Maybe. But you've got to have a word, or it won't matter. You'll blow it anyway. Have you done that before? We've got to have a word. Whatever your situation is, you must have a word.
Yes.
Are you catching this?
Yes.
God, give us a renewed belief in the power of your... See, the power of God, the way he's chosen to relate to us. I don't know how he relates to all his other creation. I don't know what all else he's got. I don't know. All I know is what he's revealed to me right here. But I know it says he made us. And in this creation, in this realm, where earth is and you and me, the way he has chosen to send me something has been through his word. The way he created this whole thing was through his what? Word. Because his words are the containers of his will. And they are the containers of his power. So I don't know if you got saved yesterday, if you're not saved yet, if you've been saved since 1950. But you're going to have this word, because man shall not live by bread and his own wisdom and his last year's experience and what he learned 40 years, but by a new word, a right now word from God. Are you in the book of Mark? I'm just going to teach a little bit. I'm not going to preach long. Thank you. I want to go through some of these verses with you. I just have three things I want to show you. I gave you a tool. I don't have time to really explain that tool, but I gave it to you in your bulletin. Especially, I don't mean to say it's not for the ladies too, but because, man, I charged you with something, I wanted to equip you to do it. I don't want to ask you to do something you don't know how to do and then hold you accountable to something you weren't equipped for. So, I'm asking you to read these verses and to read your Bible and to hold your family and all that, lead your family. But I put something in your bulletin. It's called the So What Bible Study Method. We developed that as a church in 2004. And we've seen it help a lot of people learn to study their Bible. Because a lot of times we open the Bible and we just go, oh my goodness, where do I start? I don't get it. Hey, you're not the only one. And we created this as a tool for you to take it. And all you have to do is follow it. 1, 2, 3. It'll teach you what questions to develop a pattern of receiving understanding when you read the Bible. If you go through that tool, that one specifically is designed for books of the New Testament. If you go through that tool and you read a passage, whether it's 10 verses or I wouldn't read a whole chapter normally. I would just take a little passage and use that tool. If you go through it and you don't get something out of it, you call me. And I will sit down with you one-on-one personally, and we will go through that thing. And I can just promise, not because of me, because of him. I promise you, we'll go through that thing, and I'll help you, and the Holy Spirit will show you stuff out of his word. He will speak to you. He will speak to you. Well, but I'm not smart. I'm not going to hush all that. He wants to talk to you. He died to talk to you.
Come on.
And then he wrote it down so we wouldn't get it confused. God is really smart. The first thing I want you to learn from that Stillwell Bible study method is how to actually set the stage for, a lot of times I always joke, I saw this in an old Western movie one time or something, we had some prayer, and they said, where are we going to read tonight, Mama? And she said, we'll let the Lord decide. And she went, oh, it is an abomination for kings to commit wicked. I mean, just, you might get something out of it. Hey, there's been times where God just met me where I was, and I did the old point on help me, Holy Spirit, and he blessed that. But if that's your normal Bible study method, there is some room for improvement. There's some room for growth. It's okay to start there, but don't say that. Because you might land on something that you don't even understand. So what I want you to do is actually learn to set the stage. We're going to look at the book of Mark. We're not dropping into Mark chapter 14. We're going to chapter 1 because we need to figure out what's going on. So the book of Mark, quick stage setting. I want you to understand, Mark, first of all, who wrote this book? Okay, good, good, good. You're already getting A pluses. Some people call him John Mark, but his name is Mark. I'm not a Bible scholar. I'm a student just like you. I study these things. I don't wake up knowing this. I look it up. I learn it. And I read that it was John Mark who wrote this book. And in fact, John Mark, what makes this gospel out of the four, Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, which makes this one pretty neat, is that Mark was not one of the original 12 apostles or disciples that hung out with Jesus. You know, Jesus had his 12, his 70, his 120, his crowds, but he had that inner circle of 12 that he really poured into to kind of place them in charge of the 11. We call them 12 apostles. Well, Mark was not one of those guys, but he still got to write one of the Gospels. That's cool, because it shows me, even if you get in this game late, even if you came in here today and you ain't even said, you can leave on a whole new playing field. Jesus just says, if you say yes, you're qualified. So John Mark says yes, and it turns out he wasn't even right there with Jesus, but he was good friends with somebody who was. His name was Peter. You ever heard of Peter? But yeah, the Apostle Peter, some people even call John Mark kind of Peter's right-hand man, his scribe, if you will. So he got all this information firsthand and accurate from the Apostle Peter, who was right there. If you know Peter, Peter didn't miss nothing. Peter was all up in people's business. Wasn't even his. If it was to be seen, Peter saw it, and he had some thoughts about it. Y'all know people like that, and not only saw it, I got to tell you something about it. Well, that was Peter. Peter saw all the stuff that Jesus did, and he shared it with Mark. Mark wrote it down. This is the first gospel that was written. It was around the year AD 65. And here's what you really want to know before you get into this book of Revolution. What was going on is, during the time of the Roman Empire, there was an emperor named Nero. You remember this from history class? Nero, have you ever heard of Nero? Nero was running things, and Nero was very self-conceited. There's a lot of drama within his family. Y'all don't have any drama in your family, I know, but Nero did. In fact, they say he killed his mom. It gets a little crazy. It's kind of Jerry Springer in there for a little bit, but the things go on. And then Nero actually, this is where history starts to argue a little bit, but most people agree. See, what we do know happened is there was a fire. They call it the Great Fire of Rome. And it happened, began around the shops, around the Circus Maximus, where they did like the Olympics and those kind of things in this city of Rome. And this fire broke out. And the fire, actually, there were 16 or 14 districts. There was like 14 districts of the city. And this fire actually destroyed 3 and damaged 7. In other words, the majority of the city, this fire, it ain't like today where they can just call 911. You know what I'm saying? They didn't have a fireman rescue app. They actually had everybody ran and got buckets. And then there was people, it got kind of weird because there was people telling them not to put the fire out. And everybody, why would we not put the fire out? But Most historians would say what really happened is Nero set his own city on fire because he wanted to build a major complex and house and palace and a series of palaces to himself. That's a little conceited, right? But he couldn't get that through Congress. Wonder why. And so he was like, well, that's cool. You know, perhaps if the major part of the city burned down, there might be some land available. So that happened in this major fire. And then, of course, people lost their homes, people lost their lives. And that happened for days. And some people say Nero wasn't responsible. Some people say he was. But it got to be where he had some problems with the people. So Nero needed a scapegoat. You know what a scapegoat is, right? Somebody to blame. You ever been somebody's scapegoat? They blamed you. You were like, I wasn't even, whatever. Okay? Well, that's what happened. Nero, the whole city had burned down almost. And Nero needed somebody to blame. And he found this little religious set of people that was just kind of a small uprising. It really wasn't that big yet. And he said, you know, it wasn't me that burnt the city. You know who burnt the city? It was those doggone Christians. They burnt the city. Well, that doesn't sound like a big deal. You're like, whatever, we didn't burn it. That ain't how it went. Not only did he decide that they did it, using as a scapegoat, he began to persecute them. In the Bible, you can read about it. There's kids present and things, so I'll be careful. But there were things that they did to the Christians that were unspeakable. These are the stories that you see where they fed Christians to lions and they were eaten alive. This is where they would open up their insides and let animals put corn in them and let animals destroy them. This is where they would saw them too. There were stories of where the Christians were actually, they would take their corpses and hang them on poles and light them on fire with oil. They would let them be the torches of the night for their events. Can you agree that the Christians were going through a terrible time?
Yes.
And you know what? They had the Old Testament from the Jewish background, but they didn't have what we call the New Testament. They had the apostles' teaching, which was starting to be written down, and sometimes they might have a letter from Paul, like, you know, Galatians, Ephesians, Philippians, these kind of letters that we study as books of the Bible. But they didn't have Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. The stories about the life and the teachings of Jesus, they didn't have it written down. And Mark knew if these people going through this hellacious time of persecution where their own children were being killed, if they were going to stand firm in the face of persecution, they were going to need somebody to write down everything they could remember about what Jesus did, or who he said he was. They needed to be strengthened. Can you say strengthened? The purpose of the book of Mark was to strengthen the people who were going through a terrible storm of persecution in their life and give them the power, the peace, and the encouragement to see God is going to take care of you. And he had to create a mindset within these people, just like Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, that where they were going through a fire, and they said, you know what, God's going to deliver me from